And what we have going on here is our clubbers of the month, our WANA clubbers of the month. And if you notice, things are a little bit different in here this week, and will be over the next few weeks. But tonight is our WANA Grand Prix night. We're very excited about that. Folks, that starts at 4. From 4 to 5 p.m. is our weigh-in and check-ins and also our concessions. And then the race starts at 5 p.m. And so church family, really need you to be faithful here to support the ministry, but also to come and help serve. And then also, if you are racing, you're a part of that, you want to be here between 4 and 5 p.m. to not only get a hot dog, but also to weigh in your car and get that in the pit ready to race, all right? And if you notice up here, we're very excited and got a lot of trophies and very thankful for what God is doing. And how many of you would like to win one of these trophies? Can I hear an amen or raise your hand? Amen. Well, you're not going to unless you're racing a car, all right? These are just for our kids, and but they're excited. I think we've got about 45 to 50 cars, Brother Jamie, and is that right, pretty much? And very thankful for what God is doing. But you listen to Brother Jamie, and these are our directors of Awana, Jamie and Paige Perdue. They lead our Awana program, and as he mentions, who our clubber of the month are, and say a little bit about it. How do they become a clubber of the month?
Thank you. Basically, how I become a clubber of the month, that once I said before, you have to say so many sections each and every week, do participate in our themes and participate in, like, there's a WANA, we have a WANA Grand Prix. They make cars that do that. They get so much extra bucks for the WANA store, and it goes accounts with the clubber of the month being here every Sunday night and just going over and beyond what they need to do to say section and memorize verses. Memorize verses is the most key thing to do that. Another thing, like Pastor said, we'd like to have y'all come back tonight and support Awana, because if it weren't for y'all, we won't be able to have Awana Grand Prix. Right. And when I call your name, just step out or come get your certificate. Trinity Dillard. Faith Young. Brent Miller, Noah Young, Jackson Stone, and Brooke Perdue. We have two more that did not make it here today. I'll just go ahead and recognize them. Brandon Daniger and Houston Hamlet. Thank y'all so much.
Amen. Could we do this one more time? Let's just give a big round of applause for all of our children. They do a great job. Amen. I'm going to invite you to stand this morning as we go into our worship service. And I'd like to read this verse for you. The Bible says in Psalm 73:28, "But it is good for me to draw near to God." The Bible says, "I have put my trust in the Lord God, that I may declare all thy works." Folks, we're here to declare how good God is, and how mighty he is, and how powerful he is. Now, I want you to know that as a one who is in Christ, God has been good, and I'm thankful for his salvation. I'm thankful that my sins are forgiven, and that I have been redeemed unto the Lord God Almighty. And today, that's what we want to sing about. That's who we want to praise, is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We're so thankful for him today.
We've waited for this day. We're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason, sing. You're the reason we're here, yes. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky.
Sing with us, church.
descending like a cloud. You're standing with us now, Lord.
Declaring,
show us your glory, show us your power, show us your glory, Lord.
Open the heavens, let's sing that together. Together.
Show us your glory, show us your power, show us your glory, Lord.
Sing that again, church. Show us your glory.
Show us your glory, show us your power.
That's what we desire this morning, is for God to fill every part of our praise. I love this next song. Such a simple song, but I'm going to tell you, it's so wrapped in truth that our God, He is the God of the ages. He is the image of the invisible God. Yes, He is the firstborn of creation, but He is the first and the last. He is the one who matters most today. Matter of fact, He's the one who matters at all. Just Jesus. Just Him.
He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of creation. He is the first, the last, the one who matters most. He is Creator, ruling, sustainer of all. We hold it all together. He is the Word of God, the hope for all the world. His name is there. Jesus, your name is lifted higher. We bless you, Lord, God of the ages, highest of all, we magnify you. Your name will be exalted, exalted. Sustainer of all, he holds it all together. He is the Word of God, the hope for all the world.
Do you believe that this morning, amen, church? Yes, his name.
His name is lifted higher. Jesus, your name is lifted.
Just say that it's you that we exalt, it is you that we praise, and you are high above the heavens and the earth. Father, you have given your Son a name which is above every name. And at that name, every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And so, Lord, may the message be clear from Freedom today and through our lives from this moment forward and forevermore, that Jesus Christ is Lord, and that it is He that we exalt, it is He that we praise, it is He that we worship and adore. We do not adore or worship a denomination or a church name, but we only worship and praise Jesus Christ. It is His message that we want to proclaim. It is His name that we desire to exalt and to lift high. And so, God, we thank you for such a sweet spirit of worship already. And, Lord, from presenting children a clubber of the month and them putting their heart and time into not only being here faithfully, but also to learn God's Word, nothing is more important than putting the Word of God into the lives of children and into the life of every adult person. Just Jesus. That's what we're about, is just Jesus. He's all that we need. Just Jesus. And so, God, we just pray for this service that there will be a continuing heart of an attitude to want to know just Jesus, just about Jesus. And so, Lord, may the message be clear. May the song be heard that Jesus is Lord. So, Father, thank you for every guest that's here, every member, every attender. We just love you and praise your name, for you are good, and we declare thy works. In Christ's name we pray, amen. You may be seated. Our ushers are going to come this morning, and we'd like to take the offering right now. They're going to come, and I hope that you're preparing to give. And in the pew or seat in front of you, there is a envelope. And I would encourage you, many have asked, does it matter how I give? It doesn't matter how you give, but it is important for you to be able to track your giving and have a record of your giving. And so if you are in the habit of maybe giving cash or whatever that case may be, I would encourage you to seal that into that envelope and to mark that accordingly of who you are. And that would be not only appropriate, but also it's good for the church to make sure they have accurate records of your giving. And so we provide that, and it also provides privacy for you. As you put money into the offering, it is a privacy thing, and it's between you and the Lord. And we're so thankful that you give. Thank you for supporting this ministry. And as Jamie said just a minute ago, and you put it right on the money there, Brother Jamie, he left the service. Well, he quit. No, he had to take the children out. He said, you know what? If it wasn't for folks like you, ministries like this doesn't happen. You know what? He's exactly right. The giving of God's people makes ministries like Awana, races like this, happen. And so I want to say to you, thank you. And why don't we do this? Why don't we just give the Lord our praise and honor and just thank him for the ability to give anything at all. Amen. Let's just go ahead and do that. That's wonderful. The Lord is honored by that. And so I'm going to pray for the giving, and then we're going to sing as you give. We invite you to sing along with us as you give this morning. Father, we say thank you for the opportunity to give. Lord, we recognize that the Bible says that every good and perfect gift comes from you. It comes from above. Lord, we trust you. We love you. And Lord, when we give, no matter what the number is, no matter what the amount is, God, if it's a penny to a dollar to $100, what matters is the heart. It's always been a heart matter. God, you love a cheerful giver, not one who gives grudgingly. And so, God, when we give, we are saying, God, we love you, and it's a joy to give to you and to give unto your work. Father, thank you. Thank you for the faithful people who have sacrificed so much and sacrificed so great for this church, for our missionaries, for our ministries like the bus, Awana, VBS, children's ministry, on and on it goes. God, things like that do not happen. People do not get reached with the gospel without support. And I'm so thankful. And we just give you all the glory and honor today and say thank you. In Christ's name I pray, amen. I love this next song, Be It Unto Your Name. If you know it, we invite you to sing this with us and just join us in just a moment. We'll have you stand.
We are a moment.
Sing with us.
You are forever, Lord of the ages, God before time. Almighty.
stand with us. Let's sing this together.
We are the broken. You are the healer. Jesus, Redeemer, mighty to save.
There's a race tonight. It's a WANA Grand Prix. It starts at between 4 and 5, weigh-ins and check-ins and concessions, and then the race starts at 5. But I want you to know, that's not the greatest race of all. Daytona had a race last week, and it was 6 hours rain delay. I'm thankful for that because I got to see it when I got home after church. Can I hear an amen? Amen. I'm glad I came to church because God held it all so I can still see it. I believe he did that just for church folk. Anyway, that's not true. It's nowhere in the Bible. But I'm thankful for that. And by the way, Martinsville will have its big race at the end of this month, the STP 500. But none of those are the greatest race of all. None of those are. And I mentioned this to you last time. Last week, matter of fact, that, you know, anyone who plays a sport, and maybe you're not a sports fan, but anybody who plays college or pro basketball, anybody who plays college or pro baseball, football, hockey, soccer, any of those games, even the Winter Olympics, or even if you're not a sports fan, or I haven't even mentioned anything you like, even those who play cards, play Uno, or go fish, or Old Maid, or checkers, whatever the case may be, all of those games, all of those events have one thing in common. They have one objective, they have one goal, they have one desire, one strategy, and that is to what, church? Amen. To win. How many like to win? Amen? How many like to be a loser? Amen? Oh, yeah, no one likes to lose. No one goes to a game and goes, woo, let's go at it. Let's lose big today. No one does that. That's stupid. No one does that. And I'm going to tell you, there's always a winner and a loser in those events, though. But this event that the Apostle Paul brings to us from
1 Corinthians chapter 9. Do you know that there are no losers for those that are in the race? The only people who lose are those who don't get in the race. You don't have to be talented, you just got to get in the race. You don't have to be smart, you just got to get in the race. You don't have to have the most ability or the most talent, you just got to get in the race. You don't have to be young, you don't have to be old, you don't have to be tall, you don't have to be short, you don't have to be thin, you don't have to be lovable. Listen, you just got to get in the race. And I'm so thankful that Paul says, all they that run, win. You know, all that race, even tonight, won't win. There'll be some who will get a ribbon or a certificate because they competed, but not all of them will get a trophy. And that's sad that not everyone will get a trophy, but that's the way that this has to be done. But do you know that when you run this race that the Apostle Paul talks about and that the Bible challenges us about, that we should all get in? Am I blinding any of you guys right there? I used to do this in high school and drive the teacher crazy. So don't do any of this, kids. So anyway, I homeschool our kids, so don't do this, honey, to mommy. But you know that everyone can win the race for lost souls. You can win that race. And it's unique. You won't get one of these, though. You know what will happen to this trophy? I would venture to say in about 20 to 30 years, you know what will happen to this trophy? Take a guess. It'll be a piece of junk. Matter of fact, you may not even be able to find it. This will be broken off. This will probably be snapped off. It'll probably have so much dust. The nameplate will probably be popped off. And this will find its way probably in a, say it, garbage dump, something. I don't know what you said, but yes. But we don't run this race to get one of these. The Bible says that we run the race not for a corruptible crown. That we run the race for lost souls for an incorruptible crown. In this day, in Paul's day, they were very familiar with the Olympics, and the race that Paul was talking about really gravitated these people, so they understood the discipline of racing. They understood exactly what he was saying, and when he said incorruptible or corruptible to incorruptible, they already knew that those leaves that were placed on those people's heads of pine or branches, that would corrupt, that would eventually fade away. But Paul said there is a race that you and I can run that will not fade away. It will not corrupt. It is incorruptible. And I'm so thankful for that. And here in our text, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, I'd like for you to look at verse 24 and 25 to start with. It says, verse 24 and 25 of 1 Corinthians chapter 9, "Know ye not that they which run in a race run all?" Well, that's why you're in it, you to run, but one receiveth the prize, so run that you may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it. He says, now you do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible crown. Say, what is all that about? What is he talking about? Well, in your handout, there should be something filled in already. It says that the context here is really twofold. It's to proclaim the gospel and win people to Christ. Can we say that together? Ready to begin. To proclaim the gospel and win. Say it one more time. Just you. Ready to begin. To say, where's that at? I'm going to teach you and show you. And by the way, the word win is not in this text, but it is from these words and comes right from the definitions of these words. I'd like for you to look at verse 19. You follow along as I read. "For though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself servant unto all, that I might gain the more. And unto the Jews I became as a Jew, that I might gain the Jews. To them that are under the law, as under the law, that I might gain them that are under the law. To them that are without the law, as without the law, being not without law to God, but under the law to Christ. I'll explain all that in a moment. That I might gain them that are without law. To the weak became as I as weak, that I might gain the weak. I am made all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. Look up here, church. Those words gain in all those verses and the phrase save some mean to win. It means to apprehend. It means to rescue. It means to capture. It means to save. And so when Paul says to gain, to save some, he's saying to win people to Christ. He's not talking about winning a trophy or even really running a physical race. He is talking about running a spiritual race. And that is why you and I are left on this earth. It is so that we can be in a race, a fight, a contest, a spiritual warfare that is to win, to capture, to rescue, to save those that are lost. Paul knew exactly what he was saying. And I told you this last week, and it's in your handout. The Bible says that our adversary is Satan. You know, the Bible says in 1 Peter 5:8, it says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Hey, I want you to know something this morning. If you are going to get in the race, understand that Satan is going to do everything that he can to get you out of the race. Satan is going to do everything he can to get you on the sidelines. He's going to try to keep you in the pit and not in the race. God wants you in the race to win lost souls to Jesus Christ. Our adversary is Satan, but also in your handout, we are trying to penetrate enemy territory. Thirdly, in your handout, you'll notice that Satan is attempting to keep people in darkness. 2 Corinthians 4:4, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. I'm saying to you today what I said to you last week, that Satan is our adversary, that there's enemy territory that we're trying to penetrate, and that Satan is going to do all that he can to keep people in darkness. And I want you to know, he's fighting it right now while I am preaching. Some people didn't get up this morning to come to church for the whole reason is Satan doesn't want them to hear the truth. Well, I'm just sleepy. No, you're not. Satan's at work. So I am sleepy. Well, welcome to the rest of us. We're all sleepy. We're all tired. We're all worn out. We all got stuff to do. We all got stuff to do tomorrow. We got stuff to do today. I'm worn out. There ain't enough hours in the day. I'm saying to you that that's not my problem. My problem is Satan. He's going to fight everything that God is for. And you better wake up, Christian, and realize that your job, your problem is not your job. It's not your family member. Matter of fact, your problem ain't even the church. Your problem is that Satan is winning the race. Say, well, he's not winning the race with me. I'm going to tell you something. You're either in the pit or you're in the race. Well, say, well, somebody's got in the pit, be in the pit. Yeah, for NASCAR, yes, they do, but not in this race spiritually. There are no pits except Satan's pits. You know one thing about pits? They stink. Amen? Some of you didn't catch that. I want you to know that there are people dying. Six people are dying every second that we sit in here. Six people, boom, gone. I wonder how many of those will spend eternity in heaven or spending eternity in hell. How many? Do you know? That's not really the most important question, do you know how many? But the most important question is, do you care? Does it bother you? Every one of us today are in a race. But how can you win the greatest race of all? That's really the question. And there were kids and Awana workers and dads, moms, grandparents, guardians, whoever. There was some frantic working going on cars for the last month. Want to know why? Because they want to get on that track and they want to make it down to the end of that before anyone else. You know what they really want to do? One word starts with a W. They want to win. Do you want to win? The Bible says in Proverbs 11:30, the Bible says, "And he that winneth souls is wise." I'd like to bring out a few things for you, and this is a series, and we won't get through all of it today, but we will get through the majority of it today, and then we will continue this, but I really want to make sure that you get and understand the context of this and the severity of why Paul brought this to our attention. In your handout, if you want to win the greatest race of all, I want to give you the first thing, and it comes from verses 14 to 18, but I want you to write it down, and here it is. If you're going to win the greatest race of all, it's going to take a heart that is sacrificial in giving. It's going to take a heart that is sacrificial, that's sacrificial in giving. Now, would you look up here? Look at your neighbor and say, "This is uncomfortable." Yeah? I'm glad no one was in that when it fell. Everyone does not like the idea of coming to church and someone talk about giving. But I'm going to tell you something. It's not my problem to talk about giving. It is my duty to bring God's truth to you. And I want you to know that it is very biblical for every believer to be a giver. Now, I'm going to tell you something, and Cindy, this isn't the handout, and so there will not be anything to bring up on the screen for a moment. But there was something that I learned a long time ago, and this was a starting place for my wife and I. And maybe giving is a sensitive subject for you. Maybe it's like fingernails on the chalkboard for you. But I want you to know I'm not uncomfortable talking about it, and I'll tell you why. It's not uncomfortable for me to talk about it because, number one, it's biblical and God honors that. And number two, I obey it. So it's not uncomfortable for me at all. Let me tell you who it's uncomfortable for. Let's just go ahead and tackle the elephant in the room. The person that it's uncomfortable with is the person who doesn't do it. Did you hear me, church? Now, listen to me as the pastor of this church. I'm not trying to rob your pocketbook. I'm not trying to get everything out of you. I'm just saying that you've got to decide where you will land on this issue of giving. Because without giving, and I'll go back to what Jamie said when we had the Awana Clubbers up here, stuff like this doesn't happen without people giving. I want you to know this right here, this isn't ours. Somebody gave that. Now, I can kick it because it's already a piece of junk. If it's ripped off the car, it's a piece of junk. Can I hear an amen? I want you to know that this stuff over here, although some of it's ours and some of it isn't, people gave. We didn't go out and buy this stuff. This stuff right here, there were volunteers who gave, who spent their money, their resources, who gave. There's people who did this stuff out front. There's a race car out front, and I'm going to run a lap in that after the service and burn donuts in the parking lot. And I'm not really, but people gave. I'm going to tell you, this cost somebody something. I don't know what it cost. But this cost somebody something. You know what they decided to do? I'm not using it. And you know what? And if I am going to use it, I'm going to let the church use it for the glory of God. If this helps get the point home about winning the race, the greatest race, then so be it. Do you want the car? You want the bumper? You want the helmet? What do you want? I'm going to tell you something. A principle that my wife and I learned, and this was a starting place. We don't do this anymore because we exceed this. We learned a plan years ago, and it's called the 10-10-80 plan. Maybe you've heard it, maybe you haven't. It's called 10-10-80. Everybody say that. Ready? 10. Let me break it down for you. 10% to God, 10% to myself, and I live the rest on 80. Everybody go, what? I know, because some of you are thinking, that ain't going to happen. Then your God's about this big. My God's bigger than the 80. Matter of fact, he's bigger than 100. He's bigger than your 10%. But I'm saying it may be a starting place for you. 10% to God. Say, I didn't think we were under the law and under the tithe. We're not under the law. Grace exceeds the law. But I'm saying it may be a starting place for you. 10 to God, 10 to yourself, which means savings. We put away 10% of our earnings. We save 10%. Do you remember that, honey? And 80. Let me tell you something. When it was happening 20-some years ago, we thought, there isn't a way. We'll starve to death. You know what God said? Not on my watch you won't. I'll take care of those who take care of the Lord's work. Now, let me be sensitive to some of you. The 10% may be a big deal. That's fine. This is not a numbers game. This may just be an illustration to help you start somewhere. But I think you can remember the 10-10-80 plan. See, I can't live off 100%, much less 80%. Then I'm going to tell you something. You're living off 100% of God's money anyway. You know that 100% belongs to him. Are you with me, church? This whole context here, and I don't want to spend a lot of time on it because I've taught on it before this context here. Paul is talking about giving, and if you go through chapter 7 and chapter 8 and then into verse 9, the whole context here is about this. People were getting all worked up about meats to idols, what to eat, what to drink, doing this, giving to that, and people were getting worked up about all of this stuff, and then they were proclaiming that Paul was taking money from the ministry. And you know what Paul said? Look, Paul said, if that's the way you feel, he said, lest the gospel be hindered by your stinginess. He says, I'll go make tents and still proclaim the gospel. And let me say this to the church today. Now listen to me clearly. Are you listening? Everybody do this. When E.F. Hutton speaks, what? Some of you don't even know that commercial. I just dated myself. We are old, but I remember that commercial. When E.F. Hutton speaks, everyone listens. I want you to listen to this and listen to this very closely. And I'll break down a few of these verses. And I want to say this as sensitive as I can. But if you don't hear what I say, you will misquote what I will say. And you will gossip about what I say. But hear the truth today. I'm going to say two statements to this church right now. And I mean it with every fiber of my being. And I'll back it up with the scripture. You can't pay me enough to preach the gospel. Did you hear me? You can't pay me so little to keep me from preaching the gospel. I'm going to say it again because some of you are not getting it. You can't pay me enough to preach the gospel. But you can't pay me so little to keep me from preaching the gospel. Paul said, woe unto me if I don't preach the gospel. We don't do it for the money's sake. And I thank God that my family, by your generosity and your grace and your love and your sacrificial giving, that my family can live on that. I thank God for that. And the staff here knows that no one here is owed a job. Not the preacher, not the administrator, not the support staff, not the secretary. Hey, no one deserves a job here. It's by the grace of God that we can put food on the table. And guess who does it? You do. But I'm going to tell you something. You let this money stop coming. You let the money stop coming in. You stop writing the check. You stop tithing. You stop giving to the Lord's work. I'm going to tell you, I will not shut up about it. I will not keep quiet about it. If I got to go down the street, if I got to go up the street, if I got to sling some garbage, if I got to work on race cars, if I got to start going back to construction, I'll do what it takes. But it ain't going to keep me from preaching the gospel. And I'm saying to you, don't clap, don't clap, don't clap. I'm saying to you, do you feel that way about Jesus Christ? Good night. Help the preacher who will only stand in the pulpit for a paycheck. God help that man. And God help you when you come every week and suck up the church's ministry and not give a dime. And I'm saying what Paul said. Listen, it takes finances for the work of the gospel to go. He says, if you don't want to give, that's fine. But please don't say the only reason you give is to support the Apostle Paul. He's like, please don't say that. I'll go somewhere else. Someone else will help me. He's not saying I'll go somewhere else where they'll pay me. He's saying, listen, there are other churches that'll support it. What do you think missionaries do? Do you think their churches like Paul and Penny Hessman, who will be here this coming next month, do you think people like Elijah Sortow in Romania, do you think people like Tom Huffman, who planted a church in Albuquerque, New Mexico, do you think that those churches can support them totally? If they could, then why do they come here year after year trying to raise support? I'll tell you why. Listen, we will continue to proclaim the gospel, whether the church can support it or not. We'll go outside and get resources in to support it. I noticed one thing about all this racing. There's a lot of supporters on this stuff. You look at all them racetracks, you know, they got stickers all over it. Want to know why? Because they need people to support it. Somebody's got to fund it. And I'm telling you, somebody's got to fund the race here for lost souls. And it's got to be the body of Christ. Listen, I don't expect the lost to come in church and fund the race for lost souls, just like I'm not going and supporting Budweiser for the lost. Did you hear me? I ain't supporting pornography. I'm not supporting abortion. I'm not supporting sin. I'm not supporting beer or alcohol or drugs or any of that other stuff. Why? That ain't my race, but I am in the race for lost souls. And I'll tell you what, I'll give for that race. That race is worth investing in. That race we can win. And I'm saying to you what Paul said to us, it will take sacrificial giving. The key word is sacrificial. Because here's what we automatically think. Oh, Lord, he's talking about giving. I ain't been here in 6 months, and the Sunday I show up, he talks about giving. Well, I want you to know I didn't write this message for you, but it is for you. Let me tell you something. It's for me. Everybody say, it's for me. Yeah, it's for me. It's for me. Some of you automatically will think, I can't give anymore. Then why are you still talking about it? No one's arguing that point. Man, I'm doing all I can do giving to the church. Hey, thank God you're giving. Amen. Thanks for being obedient to Jesus Christ. See, that ain't the category that's the problem. It's the problem of those who aren't giving at all. And I'm saying to you that it takes sacrifice. That means you got to give up a Happy Meal every now and then. Okay? You got to give up a biscuit every now and then. Okay, that coffee, you'll have to set aside for a moment. America, hey, listen. Not trying to make this uncomfortable for you, but America spends more on dog food than they do giving to the church. Now, I didn't make that up. That's a George Barna research. You can look it up. You can go to barna.org and you can look it up on giving. America spends more on dog food than they do giving. Now, I'm all for dogs. I have one. If it was up to my kids, we'd have 10 of them. And no, I'm not looking for a dog or a cat. I'm not looking for any more animals. Amen. And don't talk to my kids about it. I know what you do. Tell your daddy I got a cat for you. I know how y'all work it. Y'all work that thing, man. Daddy, so-and-so has a kitty. It's so cute, and y'all describe it. Hey, listen. Do you spend more on cable and satellite than you do to the Lord's work? Say you against cable and satellite? Nope. I like ESPN. I like getting the news. I don't mind that. But let me tell you something. None of that supersedes what I give to the Lord's work. So that maybe that's what you can do. Maybe it is what I can do, but I'm going to tell you something. It doesn't come without some sacrifices. Because we have given up stuff, and we'll do stuff if it cuts into our giving. It's that important to us. Is that so your staff can get salaries? Nope. We've already told them, you might have to start popping out some tents. And we won't do it with a complaint of spirit and a complaint of heart. Now, I believe a person has to do what they have to do to make ends meet. But let me tell you something, church. Let me say this to you very clearly. You don't pay me enough to preach, but you also don't pay me so little to keep me from preaching. That is not why you do that. You do it so I can have lights on like you do. I like hot water. It helps. Amen? I like for the toilets to flush, and I like the stove to come on to cook. I like heat in the winter. I like AC in the summer. Can I hear an amen on that? Now I say that's a carnal need. And you know what? I thank God that you meet my carnal needs. That doesn't mean sinful. I thank God, Brother Jerry, that you and your wife give. I don't know what you give, but I know that you give. Okay, because you're leaders in this church. And our leaders give. But I thank God that you give so my wife and I can go to the store and buy groceries. Man, I thank God that you give so I can put some beans on the stove. And I thank God that you give so my wife can stay at home and raise our family and teach our kids the word of truth through a program so we can raise our kids at home and so I can spend time at home. But I thank God for that. Listen, it's from your generosity. It's from your grace giving. But that's not why you give. You give so the work of the Lord and the gospel can be proclaimed. Good night. Listen, I can eat a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. I ain't above it. And I'll eat it for a week. I'll eat it for a month. We've done it. And we'll keep doing it if that's what it takes. But don't stop giving to keep the gospel from getting out. That's what Paul was saying. Good night. If you think that we're chargeable unto you, he says, if you think that this is just to make, he says, we don't want this to be of a charge. If you think that's the only reason that we come, please don't have me. But I'd still like to come and preach the gospel, he says. And some of you have asked, well, why don't we have so-and-so here? And why don't we have this group here? And why don't we have this group? And why don't we have this speaker? I'm going to tell you know what all that cost? Money. But here's one thing I found out about our missionaries. They never ask for money. Can we just come and present our ministry? Can we come? And I'm like, we're not taking up a love offering for you. Say, what's that table in the back? That table's back in the back so you can give to them. And the church is doing some things different. We're going to write them a check and we're going to give them something. But we're not taking up the love offering anymore for them. Say, why not? Because when we give in the love offering, what happens is the ministry of God here locally suffers from it because we robbed Peter to pay. Thank you. And you know, none of them have a problem with that. None of the missionaries have a problem with that. They're like, hey, man, that's no problem. We understand. Because we'd like the lights to be on the next time we come. Right? Listen, I'm saying to you, it takes sacrificial giving. So every time you see a missionary that comes in, every time you do that and you give an offering, you just say to your Lord Jesus Christ, yep, yep, yep. Hey, they're here because I give and I thank God that I can do that. Woo, I support a missionary. I'm going to tell you something. That's something we're rejoicing over. Now, don't brag on it to me. Just brag on it with Jesus. You ain't got to tell me about it. You just tell the Lord about it and you brag on that. And I'm going to tell you something. There's a principle that he used here, and it's the same principle. It's a principle for today. Obviously, we're not under the law here in verses 14 through 18, but I want you to know this. It's important that the ministry happens, and it only happens the proclaiming of the gospel through the giving of God's people.